Welcome to another episode of IGN Unfiltered, our monthly series where we sit down with the best, brightest, most interesting minds in the video game industry. And I am joined by one of the best, brightest, certainly, Ed Boon. Ed, thank you so much for having us. We're in your motion capture studio.
Yes.
Deep within the heart of NetherRealm.
Yes, yes, yeah. This is we've been here about a little over 6 years now, and I'm glad to do this.
So yeah, we're motion capturing this whole interview. You'll be able to play this interview as an Easter egg in Injustice 2. No, you won't really be able to do that. But I appreciate you having us here. This is the longest I've ever traveled to do an Unfiltered, and I'm just delighted that you've had us here.
Oh, cool.
Because you've had an incredible career that I am very eager to ask you about. And I wanted to start and ask you about Chicago. That's where we are. That's where you're from. You're a Chicago guy. You're obviously still here.
Yeah.
Curious, why do you think there isn't a more active game development community in Chicago? You know, there are a couple of big studios, but it's nothing like the West Coast or a Pacific Northwest.
Yeah, it's probably because it's cold. You know, that's a big part of it. You know, I think game developers tend to like to relax as much. You know, when they're not working on games, which is a lot, they like to have something to enjoy, the sun. We have a good several months of really nice weather, but it gets really cold, especially now in January. It's pretty tough to find outdoor activities.
Did any work get done the day after the Game 7 of the World Series here? I have to ask as a baseball fan.
Yes, actually, believe it or not, yeah, we were pretty knee deep into our latest game, and so everybody was talking about it, but it was. We actually got back to work, yeah.
And that game is Injustice 2. We'll get to that. But I wanted to back up a second. I'm curious, were you always interested in games as a kid? When did you know that you wanted to work in games for a living? Was it one of those things where you planned it out, or did you kind of stumble into it?
I think my first exposure to games was pinball machines. You know, there was a bowling alley down the street from, not down the street, but couple miles from my house that we were growing up in, and you know, my parents would like let my brother and I, you know, just kind of go crazy, you know, in this arcade, and so I was really into pinball.
Yeah.
And one day they moved into this big machine called Space Invaders, which was like, you know, oh, a video game, and my brother really attached to it and was playing it, and I was kind of rejecting it because I liked pinball and
pinball,
all that stuff, and then I started playing it. Soon after games, you know, Pac-Man and all that stuff came out. And when Defender really hit, there was a game called Defender, an arcade game. That's when I really got hooked on a game. That was your killer app, as it were. Yeah, exactly. That's the game that really got me into not only being into the game, but into, you know, how they made it. And I read this magazine called Joystick, which covered the two guys who made it, you know, Eugene Jarvis and Larry DeMar, and they, you know, I was just reading about them and, you know, how they're making games, and that really intrigued me. And so, as much as I loved playing games, I was also into the science of making them. So I got a personal computer, started putting pixels on the screen, and learned assembly language, and from that point on, that was really kind of my you know, when I got just kind of hooked in the game industry in general.
So that, I mean, that clearly, so there was a, like a, just a latent seed in your brain somewhere, because most people probably would just play the game and enjoy the game, but you had that curiosity to want to learn more about it.
Yeah, and pretty quickly I was more interested in how they were made than the games themselves. You know, like I would see something and it's almost like, you know, you're almost like studying it.
Yeah.
You know, how did they scroll the screen? How did they get so many, you know, sprites
on
the screen?
Are you, 10 or so at this point?
No, maybe, no. I was like 15 or something,
okay,
like that. Or so it was pretty young, but, you know, just getting into, because I remember looking into, like, you know, our high school, you know, computer science class and whatnot for starting to actually take it a little bit more seriously.
Yeah. So you graduated from the University of Illinois, ended up, according to your Wikipedia page, working on over 20 pinball games at Williams over the course of a couple of years.
Yeah, I don't know if 20 might be a high number, but I touched a whole bunch of them.
Sure.
You know, and you know, and I did the voice for a lot of pinball machines, oddly. You know, at the time when you're making pinball games, we weren't hiring actors like we do now.
Right.
We were, it was like, you know,
the developers.
Yeah, right? Exactly. And I would do a bunch of funny voices and stuff, so somebody would say, oh, can you, you know, come in and be this jet pilot for this game, and can you be the game show host for this one, and be, there's a game called Funhouse where it had a talking puppet that would kind of taunt the player. There's like 100 lines, and they got me to do that. And so I did. So if you count the voices games, I think you can, it could be as high as 20.
So I'm curious, because I love pinball. We have a couple pinball machines at IGN. What's the design process like for pinball, and how does it sort of compare to a video game? Because, you know, again, it's got to be or is it a different process?
It's a completely different process. It's you know, it all starts with, I guess, probably the theme and the play field are at the same time. So you say, we're going to make a game called, you know, at the time, there was one of the first games I worked on was a game called F-14 Tomcat. So it was, you know, it's gone, you know, that was when Top Gun came out.
Sure.
And that was the big rage. And so they knew that was going to be the theme. The playfield designer would lay out the shots and where the bumpers are and where the lanes and everything are. And it's on a white wood. It's a piece of just a piece of raw wood. And when they would hook up all the switches, then they would give it to the game programmer, who was me.
Right.
And then we would start programming in rules and saying, okay, this score is this amount, then you got to lock the ball here and do all that. And while you're doing that, the artist is working on the graphics for the back glass and for the play field. And then it all kind of comes together. And, you know, projects were about, when I was working on them, they were about eight months from beginning to end. And some were quicker, some were longer, but that's basically the process.
Is there one that sticks out as your favorite pinball game that you worked on?
That I worked on? Yeah, there was a game called Black Knight 2000. It was actually the last pinball game that I worked on. And it was vicious. It was like just a mean game. But if you were good, you really had a good time. But I mean, I would see
the Dark Souls of pinball games.
Yeah, 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 exactly. I that game, and I did a game called Taxi before that, which I really enjoyed as well too. But there was a number of games that had a lot of fun.
So if you loved pinball as a kid and then you end up out of college working for Williams making pinball games, I mean, was that like a dream job to you?
Yeah, you know what? My resume, I was looking for, you know, a job, you know, like I was sending it to banks, and you know, and I never thought that, you know, that this, you know, dream job would actually become reality.
Yeah.
I was just like, okay, I'll end up working for a bank and doing programming and then doing this game stuff on the side. And one of my resumes had actually the only resume I've ever made in my life has had had a little asterisk at the bottom, and it said interest in video games. You know, and it was like more of like a hobby I was referring to. And a headhunter got it, and then he sent it to the guy who was the head of software for the pinball division and said, you know, you interested? And then they gave me a call, and I walked in there thinking that it was an interview for a video game programmer.
Yeah.
Because the guys were there with the guys who did Joust and Defender and all these games that I was like, you know, idolized. And he's talking to me, and he's going on and on, and then he said, you know, and he mentions pinball, and I go, pinball? And he's like, yeah, this is for a pinball programmer. I was like, oh, I thought it was video game program. I'm sorry, you know. And then he goes, are you still interested? And I said, yeah, I'm interested. And so that got me in, you know, I got that job, and that was at Williams Electronics. And they were building the next wave in video games, like their new hardware for a game called Narc at the time.
I love that game.
Yeah. And so they were doing that downstairs while I was working on pinball. So I kept going downstairs and talking to those guys and saying, you know, oh, you know, getting excited about that. So when I finished my last pinball game, you know, I kind of talked them into letting me join the video department.
Interesting. Yeah, what I remember about NARC are those damn Dobermans.
Yeah, yeah, biting you.
Like,
yeah,
oh,
yeah,
man.
Yeah.
So at what point do you meet John Tobias?
John was really young when he got to Midway at the time. He was like 19. And John arrived with about the same time as another guy named John Vogel. They shared an office, and it was adjacent to mine. And John started working on a game called Smash TV. That was
the
first
game
he was working on.
Absolutely.
And
I buy that for a dollar.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I was working on a football game called High Impact Football, either that or the sequel. And then John and I were talking about, you know, games in general. And at the time, there was a game called Street Fighter.
Yeah.
Street Fighter 2 came out. And, you know, at the time, the characters were huge on the screen. And we were talking about, you know, we have digitized graphics. Their characters are so huge, but they're kind of like anime kind of drawn. How cool would it be to do, you know, a game that had big digitized graphics? Because the bigger the images are for digitized graphics, the better they look, the more realistic they look. They're less pixelated. And so we, you know, we just kept that conversation going on while we were working on our games. And then we put a demo together with using images from the movie Bloodsport, Jean-Claude Van Damme, and everybody got excited about it. And that was kind of like the catalyst of you know, starting the first Mortal Kombat game.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
What do you think made you guys such good partners?
We had a really good, John was a really good artist, and I was a competent programmer, and between us, we can implement any idea that we came up with. So I had a lot of ideas for visuals, and he was like, okay, I can do it like this, and he would have ideas for like the gameplay stuff, and so we both contributed on any area that we wanted, like you know, so it's just us,
yeah.
You know, so, you know, let's just, and so I think that, you know, that was really kind of the core of why, you know, if you had an idea, the other one agreed, yeah, that's cool, we can make it happen. It was a really, it's a really good relationship in that respect that we didn't, there wasn't like this line of you do this and I do that type of thing. It was we're doing the whole thing.
Collaborative, yet clearly you kind of had complementary skills.
Yeah, exactly.
So you mentioned a minute ago the sort of genesis of what became Mortal Kombat, the digitized graphics, but when did that become Mortal Kombat? When did you guys lock in on, oh, this is it?
There was one moment. There was a moment when, like I said, we were using images of Jean-Claude Van Damme and piecing together something that was kind of really crude. And but then we got, you know, some of John's friends, you know, knew, you know, wushu and karate and all that stuff like that. So, you know, we went to a costume store, we got a, you know, we were trying to make a Jean-Claude Van Damme game.
Right.
And so we got a, we went to a costume store, got, you know, found pieces of costume that were, would look like Jean-Claude did in Bloodsport. And we had one of John's friends came in and, you know, kicked and punched and did all these things for us. And one of the moves that we had was the uppercut. It was like, you know, you're ducking,
oh, yeah.
You hit the high punch, you know, screen shakes, you know, a guy flies up in the air and lands on the ground. And, you know, when we got that happening, I remember like just that stupid little, you know, uppercut and the guy landing and everybody, you know, and the blood flew. And all of a sudden, that's when like people were like coming into my office and like, I heard about this uppercut. You got to show me it. And I show it, you know, 10 guys in a row would come back doing that. And that's when we were kind of like, okay, something cool is happening here. I think that's when the game became what it is, you know, like as far as Mortal Kombat.
Did fatalities, was that sort of the next natural step?
No, fatalities didn't come until later. When I played a lot of Street Fighter, and one of the things about Street Fighter that annoyed me and I loved was when you get the other guy dizzy. You just beat the crap out of them, and then they're like dizzy. And when you're the guy who's dizzy, you're just like, oh God, now you get to hit me again, you know, like that. And that was such a bad feeling. And it was such a good feeling when you're the guy who's attacking him. And so I was really kind of feeling, you know, I want to have that good feeling, but I don't want to give the other guy the bad feeling. So we moved the dizzy to the end of the fight. When you lost, so you're dizzy. And then we just give the guy, okay, now here's your chance.
Just finish him.
And usually people would just do an uppercut and that would like feel better.
Yeah.
And then that kind of evolved to, what if you could do something special at the end? And then kind of the rest is like history.
Do you remember which fatality came first? What was the first one?
I think the Kano tearing the guy's heart out. It's so cliche martial arts movie type of thing, you know? Because we would say, you know, you could show your heart before you die.
Right.
No, that was a big, you know, some myth in some kung fu movie.
So when did you first know that Mortal Kombat was a hit? Was there a moment that you can remember that you were sort of like, this is, life's not going to be the same anymore?
Yeah, I think there were a few stages of them. The first one was when we brought it to an arcade and there was a literal crowd around the machine, you know, and you know, you would see something happen and the whole crowd would it was at the time younger kids were playing it. It was like, yeah, you know, 15 years old and stuff like that. And they would like run around. They were so excited. They would just physically run around when they saw, you know, Scorpion took his mask off and blew fire and burned the guy. And then, you know, how did that happen? It was such a mystery to it. There was a moment there where we were like, wow, this is pretty big, you know. And then like other stages when like the arcade cabinets that we were making would be, we just sold so many of them, you know.
Yeah.
Couldn't keep up with the demand. And probably the biggest one was, I think it was at a Consumer Electronics Show, Acclaim had the rights to publish our game. And they said, we're gonna make this game big. We're gonna put $10 million into advertising and we're going to, and I remember like, you know, they brought me upstairs and they showed me a TV commercial. It was the kids going, Mortal Kombat, you know, yelling. And I remember saying to them, you know, I think you're betting a little bit too much on this. You know, I don't think you should, you're expecting a little too much. I was always really cautious with that. You know, I did that with the arcade games and stuff. We were just like, you know, don't expect too much out of it. And they looked at me like I was like crazy. Like, you know, this is going to be the biggest thing in the world. And they, to their credit, you know, Acclaim raised it to a new level of exposure and stuff like that, that I don't think Midway would have, like, you know, necessarily put up that much kind of confidence and money into it like that.
Because, you know, back then that was, you know, early 90s, that was sort of the last hurrah for arcades, the last time that arcades were big. And I feel very lucky to have grown up in that time.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was everywhere. Do you remember, like, was it making some crazy amount of money every month from the arcades?
It was.
Would you see a spreadsheet and just be like, whoa?
Yeah, and it was, you know, our first test, the coin box got full and was jammed. And it wouldn't take, you know, and so we got a call from our, you know, from the field tech guy. And he said, you know, there's something wrong with the game. We all went there. You open the door and
money comes out.
Yeah, it just comes pouring out. And we were like, wow, this is a problem. And, you know, later on when we were doing the arcade cabinets, people were breaking into the machines, leaving the money and stealing the circuit board so they can resell it on the open market, because that was where the money was. You know, you can take your $1,000, you know, but we've got, you know, this circuit board that we can sell for really big money, because they were there was way more demand for the game than there were, you know, games that we can make.
Right. With all the controversy surrounding Mortal Kombat when it first became popular, do you have any good, like, parent letters that are still on your wall or things about, because, you know, it was, the violence was at the time, you know, very controversial.
Yeah. No, I didn't get, I don't think I got any letters. The odd thing about it was the game was out for a year, you know, before Acclaim made the home versions. And like I said, you know, we made a ton of them. We made a ton of arcade units, and they were all over the world. And this game was there, but it didn't reach like this mass market, you know, like penetration into the public and all that stuff. But Acclaim's ad campaign and stuff, like I said, they did such a great marketing job that people saw it who otherwise would have never seen it in their life. And then there was no such thing as a ratings
That's true.
There was no M-rated game. Yeah. There was no, that. It was just another video game that has blood, you know. So people's reactions were like, you know, it's kind of like explicit lyrics in music,
right,
before they had to put that in. An R-rated movie versus a PG-13 movie, you know, all that stuff. And it was our, to me, it was our industry kind of maturing to the point where it needed these kinds of things. And I was always, you know, of the opinion that, yeah, you know, a six-year-old should not be playing this game. You know, I was always, you know, I was never fighting for, no, I want little kids to play this game. It was never that.
What was it like seeing that creation, Mortal Kombat, get turned into a major motion picture?
It was surreal in a lot of ways. You know, we went to the, to some of the where they were shooting the movie, yeah, like in LA and whatnot. And, you know, so we, all of a sudden we see this big, you know, Goro,
animatronic.
Yeah, exactly. Just kind of there. So I was like, you know, so all of a sudden these ideas that we were just kind of, you know, just between us going, wouldn't it be cool if we did this? All of a sudden is being produced by a you know, a movie studio, which was a really huge deal at the time. It was kind of it was hard to kind of process of like, you know, and again, it was one of those things I was like, you know, are you guys sure you want to, you know, bet so much on this? That was always kind of like my reaction to when something would take the next step of kind of, you know, in pop culture.
I know you got to do, you got to voice Scorpion in the film,
yeah,
but were
I
you
did.
Otherwise, was you and your team otherwise creatively consulted on the movie at all?
Similar to like the Acclaim thing, but not like, you know, an official, you know, you can't make the movie without these
right.
guys approving it. We had some pretty interesting discussions, you know, they had some pretty wild like suggestions for characters. I remember them saying, you know, they wanted Danny Glover to be Raiden, you know, and they had, you know, so they had some pretty.
I'm too old for this.
Yeah, exactly. And they had, you know, Kano originally just had like a pirate eye patch, and they would screen it for, you know, we were like, you know, no, he's got to have the big plate. And they would screen it for people like, you know, focus groups, and
right.
they would say, you know, no, that's, you know, like, you know, players were like fanatics at, you know, like, you know, that is not Kano. He does not have an eye patch. He has this. And so they're okay. And so that course corrected them a few times.
Interesting. I have to ask you, why is it that Mortal Kombat is still the best video game movie ever made? What was it about it that?
I don't know. There have been a couple other ones that have done pretty well.
I realize that's sort of, I'm not trying to issue you a backhanded compliment with that, because there have been so many bad video game movies.
Yeah, there's way more bad ones.
It was good, and it still held up as like just a fun movie.
Yeah, if you looked at it from that, exactly as you described it, I think you can go, yeah, like it wasn't, you know, it wasn't The Godfather, you know, it wasn't Goodfellas or something like that. But it certainly, like scratched a lot of the itches that people wanted to see, and they was like, oh, I want to see Johnny Cage do a shadow kick. I want to see this Scorpion say, get over here. I want all these kind of, you know, so they paced it out, I thought, with, you know, these kind of nods to the game that satisfied a lot of people who love the games.
Yeah. So John Tobias ended up leaving in 2000. He started a new studio. I'm just curious, was the parting amicable, and do you guys still talk at all?
It was. You know, Midway was going through a lot of transition in a lot of ways. And, you know, John always wanted to tell a more elaborate story that really, at the time, couldn't be told in a fighting game. You know,
yeah.
Now we're doing a lot more elaborate stuff, but in the days of sprites and all that stuff, you couldn't really tell. You know, our story was really just like a paragraph, you know, introducing the character, and then a paragraph when you would finish
yeah.
the latter, and there's Johnny Cage, you know, like that was the extent of it. So John always wanted to do that, and he actually did a game called Mortal Kombat Mythologies. It was like a story on Sub-Zero. And then I was kind of still working on the fighting games, but we were kind of, you know, kind of consulting with each other and stuff. And so I think, you know, like my recollection of it is when he was working on the next game, which was called Special Forces.
Yeah.
And, you know, they I, you know, we were less involved with each other's stuff at that point, and you know, was dissatisfied with something. I guess I can't really speak for him too much about that, and you know, just decided that he wanted to go. I think John always wanted to also like have more ownership of the characters that were made and stuff. You know, Mortal Kombat was, you know, big, and you know, so I think he just, you know, decided it was time to go. So, but we were fine. You know, we,
good,
like I said, we had and you know, to this day we still talk and stuff like that. John lives in San Diego now, because you know, John was born in Chicago, I was born in Chicago, the game was made in Chicago. It's such a, you know, Chicago you know, fingerprints all over it, all over the game. And so so I was actually surprised when he moved to San Diego.
You mentioned Special Forces, and then there was Shaolin Monks.
Right.
Was Shaolin Monks his, John's as well?
Or? No, John was gone by the time Shaolin Monks came. Shaolin Monks was, it was an interesting thing. There was, we were sent like a demo of what was Raiden running around in a action adventure type game,
yeah,
which is similar in kind of perspective and all that Shaolin Monks ended up being. And the studio that was doing it was located in Moore Park, and they were kind of like, hey, you know, we'd love to do this game. And they showed it to me, and I was, I was like, wow, this is pretty cool. But my feeling was, you know, we needed to do like a little bit more. So it was kind of like, I suggested, you know, we do two characters. Let's not, you know, just have it one character. Let's have two at the same time, which introduced a number of problems, but ultimately was cool. And let's make it Liu Kang and Raiden, or Liu Kang and Kung Lao, and let's, you know, make it a lot more of a cooperative thing, you know. And so that really kind of set the direction of what the game ended up being. And then at that point, we started working with them. So I was flying to LA a lot and working with the team there. And, you know, met a lot of great developers who are still friends now. Some are on our team. Some went on to work on God of War. Some went on to, you know, like that team was, there were so many talented guys on that team that, you know, it was, and I think that was a big part of Shaolin Monk's success. Because, you know,
it was a really good game.
Yeah, Mythologies and Special Forces, you know, didn't do that well. And, you know, especially with Special Forces, it left a bad taste in people's mouths for, like, you know, Mortal Kombat games and action adventure, you know. And so we were really determined to kind of reverse that whole trend.
Was it refreshing for you to work on something else that wasn't a one-on-one fighting game at
it
that
was
point?
it was you know, the everything was different. It was a different type of game. It was a different kind of development, you know. I spent a lot of time in airplanes, but it was a lot of fun, and it was you know, something that one of the funner moments of, you know, these last 20 so years.
I mean, and that leads me, I have to ask you, I mean, be honest, do you ever get tired of making fighting games? I mean, you've effectively been doing it for 25, 30 years at this point.
Yeah, you know, we've actually had some breaks and diversions over the years that it hasn't only been fighting games. Like
you chipped in on with Rocksteady a little bit, right? One point.
Well, we did a game called The Grid, which was kind of like a third person, you know, arena type game, which was in the arcades, and it was like six machines linked together. That was a blast. We still actually have one in our cafeteria that, you know, we still play, and, you know, in the Shaolin Monks. And then we had done within the Mortal Kombat games, we did some, like, these diversions games. You know, we did this puzzle game and a little go-kart game and all that stuff, and those let us have, like, some kind of outlets for, like, you know, different ideas that we had, so.
I mean, the industry has become so much more risk-averse these days because, you know, the investment's so much higher. It costs,
yeah.
You know, it's, Are you stuck making fighting games for the rest of your career? Because you're a safe bet in that, or?
Well, it's nice to be considered reliable. I would be surprised if I never did a non-fighting game again. You know, and you know, we've had our little diversions, so I don't think that would be. I don't think I would say I'm only going to do fighting games for the rest of my life.
Are you kicking around? Do you have sort of, do you keep a diary or journal of ideas for non-fighting games
that you
add to or reference from time to time?
Absolutely, yeah, all the time. Yeah. Right now, you know, the thing is, we did Injustice, and you know, it was great that it did well, but now it's like, okay, so. Now that's a thing, you know. So we're not doing only Mortal Kombat games.
Right.
So we're kind of, so far we've kind of leapfrogged them, you know, and which is cool in the sense that, you know, we're not releasing a Mortal Kombat game every year, or every other year, and stuff like that, which I think would make things really get stale, you know.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you all. Do you think it's creatively healthy for the studio, for NetherRealm, to, as they have been anyway, alternating back and forth? Do you think it makes, maybe, I don't know if it's keeps the team from leaving? Like, does it kind of keep everybody from getting burned out?
Absolutely. That's been one of the great things about Injustice doing well is, you know, we can go into the, you know, the DC superhero headspace. You know, and we've carved out this alternate universe where Superman's a dictator and Batman, you know, they're adversary. And so that's fun to kind of like, you know, you kind of scratch that itch. And while you do that for a couple of years, then people go, yeah, I have some ideas for a fatality or something like that. And it's actually served as a really nice, you know, change of pace for the whole studio.
Yeah, have you ever talked to Todd Howard about that? Because they do that same thing too, and I feel like I haven't gotten to ask him about it, but I feel like that does the same thing for them, where they go between Fallout, that came into their lives, and Elder Scrolls.
Yeah,
you guys have that same thing going on.
Yeah, for sure.
When Midway shut down in 2011, if I have my date correct here, were you ever worried at that point about either your own future, the team's future, or the Mortal Kombat IP's future?
No. The timing of the things was interesting because it was kind of depressing in the sense of, like, you know, we were like five teams at one point. We were NFL Blitz, you know, Hangtime and Showtime.
Yeah, what NHL became Blitz a, in there.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. And then there was like this game called PsyOps, and you know, Stranglehold, and Mortal Kombat had a series of games, and then slowly over time that shrank, you know, and it was fewer and fewer people, fewer games. And before the Midway thing happened, there was already discussion about our team. Like, they were saying, you know, there's a lot of people who are you know, interested in you know, picking the team up and whatnot. And so I actually personally spoke to a number of different studios, and eventually we talked with Warner Bros., and Warner was like the clear place that we belonged, you know, just talking for a little while. But so we always knew that there was like a demand, you know, so that
gave us reassuring.
Yeah, and that gave us a feeling of kind of security, and you know, there were a lot of layoffs, and we always made a point to management, like, you know, we are not going to lay off one person on this. You know, we've never had a layoff
at
Midway or this whole time as NetherRealm. That was a big thing. And we told the team, I said, if we continue to do well, you know, we're all good. You know, and that was like a real commitment that we made. And I think everybody kind of got that at that point.
I'm just kind of curious, did you own the do you own the Mortal Kombat IP, or did Midway own it and then it transferred?
Midway owned it, and so I don't.
Does that kill you?
Enough.
Is that it's because it's your thing? And
you know, it doesn't. I don't know how to say this. I feel like I'm fairly compensated. You know, like
sure.
I don't feel like I'm being ripped off. I feel like they take care of me, and you know, that's so.
Well,
like, you know,
yeah, as long as yeah, you feel yeah, good about it, yeah, and you're yeah. not just a, you know, grizzled,
yeah,
grizzled
yeah.
guy who's ready to.
Yeah, and you know, the reality though is like when we made the Mortal Kombat, you know, there are other guys who've made games. You know, a good friend of mine, his name's Mark Trammell. He did a game called Smash TV, did NFL Blitz, NBA, you know, NBA Jam. You know, he doesn't own those games.
Right.
You know, like it, that's just, as an employee, you don't own the stuff.
Right, I don't own this.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
So once you become part of Warner Brothers, I'm curious, where does Mortal Kombat versus DC come from? Did you ask them? Did you approach them, or did they approach you about it?
No, actually, that wasn't Warner Brothers. That was part of Midway.
Oh, it was? Okay.
At the very tail end of Midway, one of the sales guys was, you know, he was into, you know, connecting dots, you know, connecting, you know,
yeah.
making deals, that type of thing. And he approached us and said, what do you think about doing a Mortal Kombat versus DC thing? And there was a novelty with us of, oh, wow, you know, that'd be fun to see Batman and Scorpion in the same frame. And there was a little bit of a who would win in a fight, like fantasy type thing
yeah.
that could happen. And so so they actually approached us to doing it. And again, it was at the tail end of the Midway thing right before the transition into, so there was a lot going on. There was a whole lot going on, and that's basically how that kind of came to be.
Would you ever revisit that now that it's just all you literally work on, just be smashing the two games you're working on together?
No, I think in retrospect, Mortal Kombat, part of its identity is the crazy violence. You know,
yeah.
like it's almost cartoonish at this point. And we could not do that in MK versus DC. And at the same time, you know, the DC games, the DC universe is it's not that dark and stuff. And so we kind of put two things together that are great in their own right, but like what was so exciting is like at towards the end of that game, we knew the next game was going to be a pure Mortal Kombat game, and the game after that was going to be a pure DC game, and that so it set the stage really great for like MK9 and Injustice.
Yeah. Well, I have to ask you, you know, that dream crossover scenario, Street Fighter versus Mortal Kombat.
Yeah,
is that a
yeah.
thing you'd even ever want to do, even if the politics of it could align, based on what you just said?
Yeah. There's part of me that's like, you know, that would be such a cool dream. And then there's another part of me that goes, there's no way that would satisfy everybody. You know, like even if we said, okay, it's rated M, so we can tear Ryu's head off. And you know, I think that there's a, the games play so differently. There's different pacing. There's different, you know, kind of fundamentals with both of them that I think, unless you just said, kind of like, I think Capcom tried to do it with Tekken.
Tekken, yeah, I was just going to bring that up.
And I mean, there were other issues with that game, but like, you know, they said, okay, it's in the Street Fighter thing, and we're just going to bring Tekken characters
right.
and play
and
in the Street
Fighter.
Right,
and they were going to do the vice versa that never
exactly.
came around.
Exactly, exactly. And, you know, as a fighting game fan, I was like, oh, wow, that's cool, I'm going to see that. But it just, I don't know, there's something, it's hard to put your finger on that, like, one of the licenses or one of the things is going to have to sacrifice something. And I don't know if we'd be able to find that sweet spot of it. But as far as like, you know, from a game player standpoint, or wouldn't it be cool thing, that would be the biggest news, you know. It'd be
so if Capcom calls tomorrow and says, Ed, we want to do this, you're going to tell them, you're going to say no?
Well, I'd say, well, who's doing it? You guys?
You. What if you get, what if they're offering it to you?
And I'd have to entertain it. I'd
yeah.
have to entertain it. And you know, we'd probably do like a whole ton of research with, you know, Street Fighter players, what do they want and stuff like that. So,
well, all right, there it is, Capcom.
Right.
Pick up the phone. Let's see, I asked you that. What do you feel like is the biggest difference now between the fighting game community now versus when Mortal Kombat first took off in the 90s?
Organization. There's big tournaments all over the place.
Yeah.
The online is a huge thing. One of the biggest problems when arcades kind of went away was, how do you find competition? The whole fun of fighting games is, defeating the guy, a real person.
Yeah.
Being the best guy, winning 30 in a row, something like that. Being the one that everybody's trying to beat and stuff like that. That kind of went away when arcades went away. There's, you might have a Golfland or something, one of these really high profile yeah. places that stuck around. But for the most part, really vital element in fighting games went away. And then online was introduced, and that kind of brought some of it back, but even that had lag and stuff, and we're just kind of catching up to that. So I think that's the biggest thing is competition, and the direction we've taken it are, we're getting a lot more elaborate into storytelling and whatnot, which some of the other games are kind of doing that too.
Yeah, I mean, does online, you told the great anecdote earlier about the literal crowd around the machine and people being physically brought to run laps around
yeah,
it when they
yeah.
did something cool. Do you miss that? Like, does online, because obviously online's great because it can connect people from anywhere, but
yeah,
is there an element of that that's a little, not sad, but that's like, oh, it's not the same?
Yeah, it's definitely not the same. I mean, there's a social aspect to it. There's, while you're waiting, you're talking, looking, commenting on
yeah.
the guys who were playing the game and stuff. That was a big, I'm sure, lifelong friendships have been made because of fighting games. Like two people who are both into a certain game really got into it and had a rivalry and would go to different arcades. I knew back in the day people would, they'd spend a night driving to different arcades and seeing who their competition and everything is. So there's like that social component that, as cool as it is to play somebody, across the country, having somebody right next to you is always going to be a little bit more fun.
I am curious, what games do you like to play when you're not playing fighting games? As a guy who's designed almost nothing but fighting games for so long.
I certainly don't have the time to play 100 hours of Grand Theft Auto or, like some people,
yeah.
like some people say, yeah, I spent 100 hours in Skyrim. I was like, where did you find that time? and that was, I'd love to be able to do that. But, this job is very time consuming. It's in a number of areas. So to the extent that I can, I'll at least try to play a game to, take in what it is that they did was cool, I've played The Last of Us, Gears of War, God of War, all of the,
yeah.
The bigger name stuff. I played a little bit of Fallout and stuff, Fallout 4, too. But like I said, there's no way, unless all I did was play that game. The games are so big now. Fallout's like hundreds of hours of gameplay and stuff. I dabble in a number of things, and some games will get your attention more, and some will do it. So like, but and I also I'll play Street Fighter, I'll play Tekken, and stuff like that. So
have we ever accidentally maybe played against you online in Street Fighter?
Maybe I definitely don't put my real name up there and stuff like that. I made the mistake of doing that once. I got all these friend requests.
Yeah, that's what
happens. It's kind of like, so I kind of learned that lesson quick.
So you have had, last question I have for you, Ed, is, you've had a absolutely fascinating and incredible 30-year career thus far. That's a long time in one field. You're certainly still a fairly young man, but do you think about retirement at any point where, how many more games do I have in me and do I want to, you mentioned how time consuming the job is.
Yeah,
so
it is.
Do you think about sort of the next phase of things at any point?
Only in the standpoint of, I think I have more years behind me than I do ahead of me working. Like, there's no way I could see myself in 30 years from now, still making games. let alone being alive, maybe.
82-year-old Ed Boon on Mortal Kombat 39.
Yeah. So I don't see it from that respect. But at the same time, you know, there's with our studio, you know, we have like 200 people almost, you know, in the studio. There's always, you know, an idea that comes out that excites everyone, you know, and so that's like the, you know, just when you're finishing a game and you're completely burned out and you kind of, you know, cross that finish line, you know, you find yourself having a discussion about how can we do this better and how can we do that better, and it's just like a natural, I guess like the seasons, you know, it's like it happens.
Renewal.
Like, yeah, exactly.
Death and renewal.
Exactly. And but at some point, you know, I'm sure, you know, I don't know when though, because I haven't really thought about, you know, picking a date or anything like that. All I can safely say is I have more years behind me than in front.
You're going to find a nice, quiet, tropical beach somewhere when Injustice is done? You like to disappear for a little while?
Yeah, you know what? There's a million things that I love doing outside of work. You know, I play basketball twice a week. I golf. I play, you know, piano, learning to play guitar. And, you know, there's a ton of stuff that I'd love to do because I don't have time for that either.
Yeah.
You know, so I look forward to that in that respect. You know, so there's no way I would like retire and stop doing stuff. I'd have more time to play games. I'd have more time to do those things. So that's pretty much how I look at it.
All right, well, Ed, thank you so much. Injustice 2 is out May 12th. Was that it?
Sixteenth.
What did you put on your Twitter account?
May 16th.
That sent everyone into a frenzy.
May 16th.
May 16th. Injustice 2 on PS4, Xbox One, and PC as well, or just the consoles.
We haven't announced anything yet.
All right, fair. On probably the platform of your choice. Ed, thank you so much. And for more from the best, brightest, most fascinating minds in the games industry, be sure to look for a new episode of IGN Unfiltered each and every month.